Today's episode of This Week in Startups is brought to you by Walker Corporate Law, a boutique law firm specializing in the representation of entrepreneurs. Visit them at walkercorporatelaw.com. And Citrix Sharefile, secure file transfer built for business. Visit sharefile.com, click on the microphone, and enter TWIST for a free 30-day trial. And by AWS Activate, the Amazon Web Services startup program. It's easy to start and scale your business with AWS. Visit aws.amazon.com/activate. Hey everybody, it's producer Gina, and this is This Week in Startups. The interview you're about to hear was recorded at Launch Beacon in New York City. Jason sat down with the top folks in retail, e-commerce, beacon technology, and much more. We hope you enjoy this chat with Ryan Caldbeck of CircleUp. He helps connect brands and retailers to backers who get real equity for their investment. Let us know what you think of the episode. Tweet at TWI Startups and at Jason.
It's what it's all about, man. They said money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you. Yeah. Money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you.
The format that we use in these events is one that moves quickly, has no bullshit, and we get right to the point. The way we do that is we don't let people just come up on stage for 20 minutes and say whatever they want. We actually do one or two rehearsals with each of these companies, which took place over the last couple of weeks, and we strip out the nonsense from their decks that you would already know or otherwise not want to hear. And then I sit with them here while we go through the decks, and I pepper them with questions to try to keep the proceeding moving quickly. So that's a good chance for me to keep it moving myself. Let me bring out Ryan from CircleUp, which is a really fascinating company. Please welcome Ryan. Welcome, Ryan.
Thank you.
So now I'll ask you the terrifying question that all entrepreneurs must face, which is explain what you do in a sentence.
We connect investors and consumer and retail companies.
Okay, so you connect investors and consumer retail companies. Why? To do what?
To help entrepreneurs thrive.
Okay, so now we're coming back, we're coming down. And what makes them thrive in your case?
In our case, we focus on the consumer and retail space. And in the consumer and retail space, finding the resources and support that you need is much more difficult than in other industries like tech. In particular, finding capital at an early stage is a very difficult thing for most consumer and retail companies to do.
So you help these companies crowdsource capital.
That's right. The term gets a lot of buzz. I mean, essentially what we're doing is we're helping to make investing into these companies much more efficient. And so crowdfunding is a term that essentially means a group of people coming together to fund a project, an idea, a company. In our case, it's a company and the investors receive equity.
So it's like Kickstarter, except with one major difference.
Which is equity. Exactly.
Okay, so I'm not just donating to see this product exist in the world because I want to feel good about it existing in the world or maybe getting one of the early copies of it. I'm investing so that I get equity in the company.
That's right, yeah. So these are sophisticated investors who are making real investments, typically 5, 6, even 7-figure investments into the companies.
So there's a bit of a chick, and do we have a deck, by the way? Let's pull up the deck. You've raised a lot of money from a lot of famous people for this. I know Google and Union Square Ventures, which Fred Wilson's company here,
that's very right.
Famous company. So you've raised a lot of money. So this has really been validated.
Yep.
Take me through an example company that's raised money with this.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, just to start, if I can make this work.
Yeah. How about the next slide? Somebody's got the computer back there. They can do that. There we go.
That's good enough. Before we get to the companies, one of the things that we do is, I mentioned before, we try to give them the resources and support that they need. So we think that a big part of that is helping the companies to raise capital. But we also think it's providing other resources. And one of the things we do is we help connect them with partners. So we have formal partnerships with General Mills, Procter & Gamble, Virgin America, a number of others that work with our companies after they raise money.
Got it. But if I'm a startup of a gummy vitamin company or a sports drink, wouldn't I be terrified to be partners with General Mills, Procter & Gamble, and the people who would steal my ideas and crush me?
It's a great question. Some are. Most aren't. The reason most aren't in the consumer space is they understand that, they understand that the General Mills of the world are not looking to steal the $500,000 idea. They're looking to buy...
Steal the $5 million idea? The $5 billion idea?
You know, in the consumer space, it's exceptionally rare for companies of that size to start brands or to buy and steal million-dollar brands. They end up waiting until the companies get much larger. And that's one of the things that most folks don't understand about the consumer and retail space. The innovation often comes through acquisition. You know, if we jump ahead to the next slide, which I'm not able to do.
Yeah, let's put the next slide up.
The returns in this space to angel investors have historically been very strong, right? And that's a thing most people don't understand, that angel investors in the consumer retail space are making money. If we jump ahead one more slide, the reason they're making money...
And those average returns were 20% a year?
20% average IRR a year. There's a couple different data sources there. The Cambridge Associates would say 20% IRR. The Kauffman Foundation would say 3.5 times your money in 4.5 years. And it's above tech. That's one of the things that a lot of people don't understand.
Above tech on average.
On average.
But the chance of hitting a unicorn or a Pegasus, as we call a unicorn Pegasus.
It won't happen.
Uber will not happen.
It will not happen.
Didn't that happen with Vitamin Water, I heard? That 50 cents?
It happened with Vitamin Water. I used to work for the firm that invested in Vitamin Water, but it is an exceptionally rare thing. Chobani is a $5 billion company. But most of the folks here work in and around the consumer retail space. You should not invest thinking you're going to have an opportunity to hit a unicorn. But I think what's interesting is for most individual investors, they don't, in the tech space, they don't have access to the unicorns, right? Mm. And so you have to think about the averages. The averages in consumer and retail are higher. You're hitting singles and doubles, not home runs, but it's still an attractive place to be. Before I was talking about the returns on our process or on our site, to get onto our site, there's a heavy curation process.
Yes. Scott Walker runs the Walker Corporate Law Group. And let me tell you something. It sounds like this big, fancy-dancy law firm. It's a group of attorneys who love founders and startups. And in fact, they've all got 10 to 20 years working at those big firms, you know, those big, big, big ones that charge a ton of money. Well, Scott Walker started a boutique law firm that specializes in only startups, and he gives flat rate pricing, so you're not getting dinged with huge bills, and he can do everything from like closing around, doing M&A, IP, all that stuff. Scott Walker does it all, and he does it all at a great price, so you don't have to worry about sticker shock when you get that PDF at the end of the month. Oh my God, my legal bill, is it going to be $10,000 or $10? I have no idea. Boom, you open it up, and you're just like in shock. You feel sick. I can tell you, every entrepreneur has this experience. Not the clients of Scott Walker. He is a great guy. He's at every event we do. Go ahead and email him, Scott at Walker Corporate Law, or you can visit walkercorporatelaw.com. His number is 415-979-9998. 979-9998, right? 415 is San Francisco, 979-9998. What a great guy. Scott Walker, thanks again for being so awesome. I mean, like literally I send one or two startups to him every month. He does a great job. His team does a great job. And they'll always just help people without charging them. Like if it's a new entrepreneur, he'll just sit there and have coffee or talk to them and explain a concept that maybe what's a convertible note, or should I do a price round, or should I do this debt fine? He'll just sit there and explain it to you. He's not looking to just crush every startup with ridiculous bills like some other law firms. He's looking to really help you build your business and grow alongside you. He's a really great guy. Everybody I know who ever referred to him has said amazing things. Trust me, I wouldn't recommend him if I didn't actually believe it and know in my heart that he does a great job. Go ahead and email Scott at Walker Corporate Law, Scott at Walker Corporate Law. Thanks, Scott Walker. And let's get back to this amazing episode.
We have thousands of companies that apply to CircleUp. And
yep.
We go through that process to evaluate which ones get on to CircleUp. We're trying to put investors in a position to succeed.
So 3,500 companies apply each month, each year?
3,500 companies have applied since we launched.
Oh, since you launched.
In April 2012, exactly. And we curate those companies down so that investors are now looking at companies that are more attractive. And they're looking at the companies that have passed a data screen for us and our investment committee screen.
Okay, so what is the benchmark? Is there a certain amount of revenue, a certain amount of sales?
Yep. Yeah. So what is it? The typical company that we work with already has $1 million in revenue.
Okay.
So that's a key distinction for us versus, let's say, a typical tech platform that works with pre-launch companies or it's a 22-year-old engineer with a business plan. For us, a typical company has $1 million in revenue, growing at more than 50% a year. The companies are doing well. In the consumer space, when you have $1 million in revenue, you might have distribution in a national retailer. And you can be in every Whole Foods in the country and only have $1 million in revenue.
They could be in every Whole Foods and only have $1 million in revenue.
That's right. Yeah. It depends upon the category.
Yeah.
But that's absolutely right. There's 400 Whole
difficult
Foods.
Difficult business, huh?
Consumer?
Yeah.
The failure rate is lower than it is in tech.
Right.
Yeah. So the failure rate's lower. The
but
returns
it's
are higher. So in terms of being harder, I mean, it's certainly harder to make to create a unicorn.
Yeah.
But the average outcome is more successful.
So of those 3,500, rather, how many did you raise money for?
So we've helped raise money for more than 40 companies, a total of more than $40 million.
Yeah. And you've been doing this since 2011, 12?
2012, yeah.
So in 3 years or so of operating, 2.5?
2 years, yeah, 2 years and a month or so.
You know, does that mean you do like 2 or 3 a month on average, or
well, it's scaling. Ramped up? It's scaling pretty dramatically. So we're up about 4 or 5x versus last year. One way to think about a comparison, two marketplaces that we use as comparisons are Kickstarter and Lending Club, which is a peer-to-peer lending platform. We raised more in our first 24 months than either of those did in their first 24 months.
So what were the companies that made it past the screening? Obviously, $1 million in revenue was the minimum. The clicker's not working up here.
I'm going to keep.
Yeah, let's do the next slide.
Playing that. We can skip ahead and go to the, these are some of the brands that we work with. So it's across the consumer and retail spectrum. Rain, the top left there, is a sunglass company. Rhythm is the largest kale chip company in the country.
I've had those Rhythm kale chips. They're delicious.
skincare, apparel, personal care, retail restaurants. It's across the spectrum.
So how did these companies raise their first amount of funding? They just went friends and family and they got their first couple of hundred K?
It depends. Sometimes we are their first round. And sometimes they bootstrap it to get to $1 million in revenue. Yeah. And so
That's
one of the things that people have misconception about the consumer space, that it's a much more capital intensive business than technology. In my view, the opposite is true. In my view, to build a $15 million technology business, you need 75 engineers. In the consumer space, you can have a $15 million food business with 5 people, and the rest is just outsourced, right? And so you can often bootstrap companies to a much later stage. But it just depends. In the case of Sustain in the bottom left, it's a personal care business created by the founder of Seventh Generation, which is a couple hundred million dollar business. He wanted to raise his first round on CircleUp. He liked the idea of having a group of passionate brand advocates invested.
So are these investors on CircleUp civilians? Are they like naive, like first-time investors, or are these like seasoned people who made a bunch of money building vitamin water?
Yeah, they're pretty seasoned. So the first investor in vitamin water is an investor on our platform.
Oh, really?
Investing on our platform. Yeah. These are, I mean, I think it just depends how you think about it. I mean, when you consider that the average returns are higher, I would argue that they're more sophisticated investors than in other industries, right? Because they're attracted.
But do you have dentists and stuff like? I mean, that's always the fear as
we don't have dentists and doctors.
Like,
no.
Oh my God, I'm going to have some like dentist or civilian like who comes in, some lawyer or whatever is going to put their 25K or 50K from the college fund in this, and then they're going to lose it, and they're going to invest in one company or two companies, and not understand angel investing is about investing in 50
right.
or 25.
No. We don't have dentists and doctors.
Yeah.
So most of the people on our site have great backgrounds in consumer and retail. So they started a consumer business, sold it to a large strategic. We have CEOs of public consumer companies that are investing personally, heads of consumer private equity firms, consumer venture firms that are investing personally.
And so you'll get people who actually invest in these companies for a living doing it as individuals.
That's right, yeah, that's right.
So they wouldn't have their firm put $1 million in yet because it's too early, maybe?
No, because the economics in a fund typically don't work. So when you have a $500 million private equity fund, the average check will be about $50 million. It's hard for them to write a $1 million check. Now, in the tech space, that happens all the time. But in the tech space, the companies are located in one or two areas, right?
Yeah.
They're not all across the country.
Density, yeah.
There's a density which allows the management of those companies to be much more efficient. In the consumer space, if you raise, let's say, a $25 or $50 million seed fund, which is so common in tech, you'd have to hire a team of people to go source those deals because they're spread across from Idaho to Florida to Texas. It's much harder to find those deals. And that's why in the consumer space, a technology platform like this is needed.
Now, I'm an investor in one of these companies, Smarty Pants, Gordon Gould's vitamin company, Courtney's vitamin company that's doing really well. They, I read in the Wall Street Journal, they raised the largest raise you've ever had. Is that still correct?
And it is, yeah. So they did a great job. It was about $2.5 million, and a good portion of that was through a platform. When a company uses CircleUp, they are not captive to CircleUp. We want to be one of their tools to help them be successful. Sometimes the entire round will come through our site, and we've had that happen many times. Sometimes a portion of the round. It's up to the company.
So in they the case put of like Smarty half Pants, their round up or something?
Around that, yeah. And yeah, that's a. We actually worked with them twice. We worked with them once last year, and they're up about 5x or so versus last year. Then they came back in this year. It's a good investment.
Yeah, sometimes you get lucky.
We've got a couple other companies that we can walk through.
Let's see it. Yeah.
If we can go to
the next slide, yeah. On the deck, yeah.
Yeah, we might have been cut off.
So. Oh, there we go. Huh. Or maybe that's the last slide.
That's odd. All right. Well, there were a couple. I'll walk you guys through them.
What do you get for doing all this work? I mean, it's got to take a team of 5 or 10 people to go through all these applications every month.
Yeah. So, one of the reasons that Google invested, and one of the reasons that General Mills of the world are interested in what we do is the data. And the data that comes with being a part of CircleUp. So CircleUp has had, I mentioned, 3,500 companies apply. When those companies apply, they give us data that we can then use to help screen other companies. So when a company applies, it gives us revenue, gross margin, valuation, growth rate, et cetera. Now, when a beverage company applies, we can look at that beverage company's gross margins, growth rate, et cetera, versus the other 200 that have applied. We can automatically screen that company and say, okay, that company has gross margins that are 10 points lower than the average and a growth valuation that's 30% higher. We don't need to spend a lot of time on that. So the first screen is a data screen. The second screen, we also have retail level sales data, which some of the folks in this room will know. We have partnerships with retail level sales companies that give us that data, and we're able to incorporate that into the system that we use to help screen the companies.
Those kombucha people are making a fortune, aren't they? Like, that's not worth $4 or $5.
Beverage is a difficult category, to say the least. If there are any beverage companies in here, it's a category where you can build huge businesses, but there is no category in consumer where the failure rate is higher than it is in beverage.
So a lot of people try.
A lot of people try. Yeah. The barriers to entry to start a company are very small, but to make it succeed are very high. So then we also, you asked before about how we screen the company. So then we have a team of investment professionals, folks that have spent their whole careers in consumer private equity to evaluate the companies to decide which ones will go on the platform. Then about 2% of the companies that apply get onto the platform. The investors then have the opportunity to decide where they want to invest. Right? And so when an investor joins CircleUp, they can invest into individual companies, or they can invest into what we call circles, which are baskets of companies, essentially mini funds. So if Jason runs a circle, I will back Jason, and Jason invests into a basket of companies.
So it's sort of like the angel list syndicate. I mean, that's what you guys get compared to most.
We get compared to them, yeah. So their largest investor is our third largest investor, Google Ventures. A couple key differences. An angel list, it's a double opt-in, so you can get kicked out of a syndicate. On CircleUp, the circle, you cannot kick an investor out. When an investor invests in the circle, you now have a fund that Jason controls, and you're able to invest wherever you want it to, but you can't just decide which investors you want to kick out.
So a group of people could say, hey, the person who did vitamin water obviously has a good sense for what's going to work in this space. I'll just give him or her my $100,000 and let them invest it in 30 companies.
That's right, yeah. And then there'll be occasionally companies where you want to increase your exposure and invest individually into those companies, right?
Now, and so what do you get for all of this? Like, what's your take on it?
So there's a couple different revenue streams that we have. First, we are a registered broker-dealer, which allows us to charge a commission. So we charge an 8 to 10% commission.
8 to 10%?
That's right.
It's a big number.
It is, and someone just said, wow.
Yeah.
It would never work in tech. This model would absolutely not work in tech.
No.
Tech companies would not pay any commission to raise money.
Yeah, no, it's considered, yeah.
Yeah, no, there's a negative connotation,
yeah.
Without a doubt.
I mean, if you had one of those, like, in tech, if you had somebody come with you to do the introductions to VCs and angel investors and take 10%.
It's a big red flag.
It's a huge red flag, like, oh my God, you're so bad at this that you need somebody to come set up the meeting for you.
It's absolutely true. Now consider I mentioned Jeffrey Hollinger at Sustain in the bottom left there.
Yeah.
Imagine a tech company where the entrepreneur built a tech business to a couple $100 million in revenue, not eyeballs, but revenue.
Right. Yeah.
And that person still needs to use a platform because it's hard to raise money. That's a kind of an outrageous proposition, right? That Jack Dorsey would ever use a site to raise money.
So if you raise $1 million, you get 80 grand. Which doesn't sound like a huge amount of money, but is there some other upside for you?
So $80,000 to $100,000.
Yeah.
Yeah, on $1 million. So we get $80,000 to $100,000 in revenue. Right. Plus warrants, we get about 2% in warrants.
Ah, so that's the real upside. The $80,000 keeps the lights on.
$80,000 per deal keeps the lights on. That's nice for us.
Yeah.
And the warrants are great upside. Yeah. We also have partnership revenue, so partnerships that pay us a fee to get to know the companies.
The GEs of the world and whatnot.
That's right. Yeah, the General Mills of the world. And so those, I mentioned before that oftentimes a large consumer and retail company will grow through acquisition. The acquisition market in the consumer and retail space is actually twice the size as it is in tech. A lot of people don't understand that, but if you look at software and internet combined, the consumer and retail market is twice the size of that. And it's because that's how those companies often will look to grow. Right? If you're running a large division at General Mills, starting a very small product line is a hard thing to get the resources to focus on. And so they typically will wait till a business gets to enough scale and then buy that business.
So they're not going to build a kombucha business in 2014. They're going to wait to see which kombucha business gets to $100 million in revenue, and then they just buy that one.
That's
it's
right.
easier.
That's right. And so in there are some cases, and Vitamin Water is actually a pretty good example of this, where the outcome has been frustrating for the large strategics, where they've waited too late, right? And so Vitamin Water was a couple billion-dollar deal, but you start thinking about what are the number of bets you could make before it gets to a couple $1 billion, to make smaller investments. So they look at us as a way to find those companies. In the tech space, this is another reason why this does not work in the tech world. You don't need help identifying the best companies, right? I mean, they're located within two, maybe three pockets in the country. And you know the connectors like you can identify those companies.
To find the Greek yogurt company in 2005.
It's much harder.
Much harder.
Right, so exactly. So there's another Greek yogurt company that started 2 years ago that's now $100 million. And that's, it's hard to identify those on something other than gut. That's one of the tricky things for a lot of those large strategics are tasting these companies, but there's not a lot of data. We help them give them the data because we're screening hundreds, thousands of companies in a variety of different metrics to identify the few that are the most attractive.
Okay, so you're going to get 2% warrants on these companies, which means you can buy 2% of the company at the previous round's price.
Yep.
So in the case of Smarty Pants, if it was a $20 million company or something, if it becomes a $1 billion company, you just got 2% of the company, it's worth $20 million, yep. And you paid very little for that. You make over $19 million in profit. 40 companies you've done already. Which one is the most likely winner in that group? I mean, have you had one that you're, telling? Because if people are going to keep investing in your company, they're going to be looking at that data, right?
Like, they will. And I think that's a lot of there are a lot of platforms out there in this world, kind of online equity investing, that are getting attention. And I think what's a shame is that a lot of journalists are not talking about that question, which is, what are the results? It's not just about raising money, it's about how does the money do after you put it to work.
Yeah.
So the average company that's raised money on CircleUp is growing revenue at 80% per year since they raised money on CircleUp. They're also expanding gross margins by 6 points. So the company's doing very well. None of them have gone to zero. So I mentioned before the failure rate's lower. I would expect over time the failure rate to be about 50% in that neighborhood, but in the past 2 years, none have gone to zero. And several have had follow-on rounds, all at much higher valuations.
So which one do you think has got the, which one or two are the ones?
I feel like I have to say Smarty Pants because you're an investor.
No,
Smarty
don't Pants. Say that. After Smarty Pants, which ones do you think are doing the best?
I think at this stage, one of the reasons, and this is not meant to be a punt at all, one of the tricky things at this stage is it's very hard to tell amongst a basket which individual ones, and that's why we encourage diversification, right?
So we say, but which one has the most revenue growth and the most revenue?
From a dollar standpoint, probably Rhythm Superfoods. From a percentage standpoint, there's several that are up.
Which superfoods?
8 to 10x. Rhythm Superfoods up at the top left. Rhythm, the kale chip company.
Oh, the kale chip company.
Yeah. So, from a dollar standpoint, that's pretty that's pretty exciting. All of them, though, are doing exceptionally well.
Thanks to our friends at Citrix Sharefile. Yes, Citrix Sharefile is designed for business, and you can use it, and you can trust it, and you can send files securely. Yes, that's right. Intellectual property, contracts, term sheets, all the important things that you do not want to attach to an email, you can send as a secure link with Sharefile. And of course, you can access these from any computer or any mobile device, and you can send files of almost any size. Here's how we use it here. We just use it to request a file. We click, and it goes to a specified folder. We get email alerts when people have uploaded stuff, so if it's a term sheet or something, I'm angel investing, and you can go see those downloads. You can control who has access to it in a very granular way with a very detailed level of permission, which is very cool. And we also share all these large video clips that we do here with the show and the conferences. So if you want to try it, go ahead and go to sharefile.com, and I highly recommend you do, and click the podcast microphone button and use the offer code TWIST. There's no credit card required, and it's a 30-day free trial. Just click on the podcast microphone button and use the offer code TWIST. 30-day free trial, no credit card required. And here's an exclusive Sharefile video for you. Yes, the top 10 questions asked and answered by the world's greatest investors, including Dave Cohen, Joanne Wilson, Dave McClure, Steve Jurvetson, Brad Feld, Mark Suster, and more. Step one, sign up for Sharefile. Use the promo code TWIST. And then number two, request a file by sending it to sharefile@launch.co. That's it. Super simple. It's an all-new video, and it's only available through Sharefile. Thanks again to our friends at Citrix Sharefile. We love you guys for just making a great product and for supporting the program. Let's get back to this amazing episode.
This work was previously done by those bankers who charge you like $5K or $10K a month retainer fees, correct?
Yeah, that's right.
How do they?
We don't charge retainer.
You don't charge a retainer, so that's nice. What do those people think about what you're doing? Like, they must really hate you for making a more fluid, cheaper process. So when they tell people not to use your service, what are the reasons they say CircleUp sucks, you shouldn't use it, you should use me as the person?
And some of them absolutely say that. So the larger banks love us because we solve a need for them, actually. Larger banks and larger private equity firms will get calls saying, I've got a $2 million food business, will you raise money for me? And the answer historically has always been no, and there's no answer on where to go. There's no solution. Now they can provide a solution, and they like doing that, they like being able to at least give an answer. The smaller banks, smaller finders and brokers absolutely do what you just said. And there's a couple reasons that they say to not use CircleUp. One is confidentiality. And so they will say, if you use CircleUp, everyone in the country will know what your revenue is, your growth rate, et cetera. To that, we remind people that companies can decide who sees their information. So on CircleUp, we haven't talked about this yet, but company applies, gets accepted, and then they have their own private deal room. They decide who gets into that deal room. And so Jason applies to the deal room, and I can decide whether or not I want to give you access based on your background. I love that you've invested in Uber, but you haven't invested in a food company, and I may not give you access because of that. So that's the piece around confidentiality.
Or I may have invested in a competing kale chip company.
That's exactly right.
You know, hey, maybe I don't want to show you under the hood what's going on at Rhythm.
That's exactly right. Another thing that a small broker will often say, and our competitors would say, is you don't want too many investors. You don't want 75, 100 people on your cap table. Now, there's a couple things to recognize there. One, in the consumer space, having more investors is a pretty common thing because of the lack of infrastructure, lack of efficiency in the angel markets in the consumer world. Right? So Vitamin Water, when TSG, my prior firm, did it, had 200 investors on the cap table. You can't imagine a tech company with 200 investors on the cap table, but that's what happened. Right? But on CircleUp...
And why is that a problem for companies, for people who don't know, having that many investors? What's the upside? What's the downside?
There's a good question about the upside. The downside, there's a number of different things, and you should ask your lawyer before you do this, but one of the downsides is it's just herding cats and dogs. So when you need to make decisions, when you need to sell the company, sometimes you need signatures from everyone, and we have 200 people to deal with. That's difficult. Another kind of... downside is 200 people now believe they have the right to ask questions. Whether or not they legally do, they believe they have the right to ask questions. In the consumer world, though, to your point, there is upside to having some investors. Now, I would say 200 is too many. We never allow our companies to go over 75, but none have gone over 50, actually, but we cap it at 75. The reason you may want more than one or two in the consumer world is to have an army of passionate brand advocates that help the business, right? So, you know, picture a baby food company where there's 30 parents that are invested into the baby food.
Affluent parents, parents with affluent money parents to put $50K into a company.
Exactly, who are putting $50K into the company because they love the company. They also like the product. And now they're talking about that product, not just because they love the product, but because they're passionate brand advocates and equity owners in the business. There are a couple examples historically of that working really well. So Ben & Jerry's and Sam Adams about 30 years ago, through a system we don't need to talk about, did a similar thing where they raised from their own passionate brand advocates. And Jim Koch has talked very publicly at Sam Adams about, you know, having the 30-year-old that invested into his company carry a pack of beer into a party and talk about, I'm an investor in that business. That tends to be a conversation starter.
And if you have any questions, by the way, Launch Beacon, and if they could tell me in the green room how many questions I have queued up, or maybe put them on the screen here, that'd be great. Thank you. There's been a lot of talk after the, the Startup Act?
The Jobs Act.
The Jobs Act, right. We call it the Startup Act, where I'm from. But the Startup Act was, the Jobs Act, allowed non-accredited, or will allow, yep, non-accredited investors, which would be investors who we would call civilians, people who don't have a high net worth or assets, to basically, instead of going to Vegas and putting $500 on black,
yep,
or red, but you would probably want black, it's always wins, but $500 into Smarty Pants or the Kelchip companies, is that going to happen? Because the SEC was supposed to have this done by now, right?
Yeah, a year ago. It will pass, or it will become law.
Are you sure about that? Because the SEC seems to be dragging their feet
They've been dragging their feet for a very long time. We think it will become law, and we don't think anyone will ever use it.
Okay, why?
The way the rules have been proposed right now, they're written in such a way, so taking a step back, unaccredited investors are those that make less than $200,000 a year in income or less than $1 million in assets. The way the rules have been written right now, they are so restrictive, it's hard for me to imagine any good company wanting to take advantage of them. So the rules will require a private company to submit their financials to the SEC, which will become public. Every single year, they require an annual audit. They require a cap, they limit the amount. They create a cap on how much you can raise in a given year. So you just think about those three restrictions. The total document is a couple hundred pages long, but if you just look at those three, there aren't a lot of private companies that would be okay releasing their financials to the public through the SEC, right? Or getting an annual audit. Now, if you don't work for a private company, you may say that an annual audit's a great idea. If you do work for a private company, or if you ever have, you realize that there's no real reason to get an annual audit.
It sounds like a $200,000 in overhead a year.
It's an outrageous proposition. Yeah. And then the third is, you know, the cap on how much you can raise from unaccredited investors. What it essentially means is that if a company is not doing as well as it planned, it can't raise money to get itself out of a hole, right? And that might be a good thing because you want to limit the exposure of the investors. The flip side is if a company is doing very well, it can't raise money to catch up. Right? So if you think of all of the unicorns, I would say with almost complete certainty, none of them planned to raise as much money in their first round as they ended up raising. Right? Uber, in their first pitch deck, did not say we will eventually have a $1 billion round.
Right.
That's what happens when companies do extremely well. Right? And so now you're saying, if it doesn't do well, you can't raise more money. If it does do well, you can't raise more money. The company's in a lot of hurt.
Yeah. Let's take a question here from the audience. Sam asks, how does criteria for a good early stage consumer retail investment differ from a good tech investment? Great question. You can put that question up on the screen, by the way.
So I can give you my thoughts on an early stage consumer retail investment. There are numbers to look at. There's historical financials, and that's one of the reasons that the investors on CircleUp really like what we do. It's not... I've heard a lot of very sophisticated technology investors say it takes 10 years to be a good tech investor, to be a good VC investor. Most individual investors are not doing this for 10 years full time. In the consumer world, there's a set of financials to look at. There's a real business. It's not just, in my opinion, putting your finger up in the air and saying, I'm going by gut here. You know, the companies that we work with will often have 3 to 5 years of an operating history to dig into. So some of the characteristics that we care about are Number one, the financials. Number two, the same store sales growth, right? So is the company performing well with the same product in the same store week after week, month after month, year after year? And it's a bit of the equivalent of kind of organic growth in the tech world. I think gross margins are key in early stage consumer. That's how you invest into growth itself. And valuation, which is something that is very important in this space because in part there aren't the unicorns, right?
So what does a million in revenue company get for an investment if they're, let's say, profitable, have a decent margin on average, but they got $1 million in revenue? How much is that company valued
at? This stage is typically 2 to 3 times revenue. Yeah. So if anyone's in the consumer space here, the idea of getting 2 to 3 times revenue may be a bit surprising because that's a high valuation. Right, and so that multiple would not hold when the business is $10, $15, $20 million in revenue. It holds at this level because, in part, you don't want the CEO giving up 80% of their business to raise $1 million. If you give 80% of your business in your first round, he's not going to be that committed. He or she's not going to be that committed to the business. Right. So yeah. Those are some of the things that we look for in the consumer world.
Last question. Direct-to-consumer brands like Everlane and some others, it seems to be a big trend, and people are making some progress there by eliminating retail, by eliminating advertising, and just, you know, lowering the margin or just making more money going direct to consumer. Have you started to see that show up in terms of applications, and how do you look at those companies because they don't have store sales?
Yep, we definitely have. Yeah, and so we look at the product sales through that channel, right? So there are different channels to sell in the consumer world. On TV is one. QVC is an amazing channel. If anyone here has ever sold on QVC, online is another great one. And a lot of the retailers and CPG companies that we talked to at the strategic level are very concerned about disruption, not just from a product standpoint, but from a channel standpoint. And you know, a lot of people would recognize or recognize that kind of the old brick and mortar of just selling through the Costco's, Walmart's, Target's of the world doesn't work. And many of them are investing. There's an article in TechCrunch today about how McDonald's is opening a hub in Silicon Valley. A lot of them are recognizing that there is disruption from a channel standpoint, and e-commerce is a key one. We think that that channel still has some of the same properties around, are you selling to the same customers? Are you selling the same product, or are you just expanding in terms of number of SKUs? So we look at that channel in a different way, but we still consider that to be a very important one.
All right, let's hear it for Ryan from CircleUp. Well done.
Thank you.
Great, that was awesome.